Just a couple of thoughts as we begin. I may repeat this in front of the next presentation as well. In 2 Corinthians 1, the next presentation, Paul speaks of the trouble that is his in Christ and comfort, the sufferings of Christ and the comfort that is his in Christ, with which he says we comfort those who are in any affliction. And I simply want to remind us that as we read Paul in these letters, and especially in 2 Corinthians, that our first response has to be that of recipients of comfort from the apostle. That is, he's the apostle and we receive the comfort from him. In that sense, we are just like any normal Christian. There are implications for Christian ministry that emerge from what Paul is saying, but the first response in any case has to be that of one of recipient of comfort from this apostle. We'll come back to that in the next presentation, but it's relevant for this one as well. This is from 2 Corinthians chapter 3, the whole thing, 1 through 18, spirit and letter, or letter and spirit more properly, in Corinth. And a couple of pre-observations on this text. First of all, it can be fit into Luther's, the cross tests everything, crux probat omnia. The issue at stake in this chapter is hermeneutical. Hermeneutics has to do with interpretation and meaning, how meaning is conveyed. I'm thinking of hermeneutics here in this chapter in particular, and also more generally, as not merely rules of interpretation or something like that is sometimes is taught. That's not wrong, but I want to suggest it's a larger reality. When I say that this chapter is hermeneutical in nature, that means it has to do with the phenomenon of understanding, how understanding is communicated, and we've already heard, in essence, what Paul has to say about that. It's not by our own wisdom understanding, but by God's self-revelation in Christ. He effectively, by the word of the gospel, communicates himself to us. It's remarkable that in this chapter, Jesus Christ is not named. It's not that Paul's forgotten Jesus, but his focus is quite concentrated upon the phenomenon of understanding, or I guess one could say conversely from the Corinthian side, the phenomenon of the Corinthian misunderstanding and how the gospel is to break through that. So the whole chapter is about understanding. The gap, if you want to call it that, in Paul's speaking about Christ in this chapter is filled in later. He comes back with a pointed statement at the end of chapter 5 that we may refer to along the way. But the absence of reference to Christ directs us to his topic, this question of understanding. It's a question then as to how the presence of Christ in the world, and especially in the apostles, is to be interpreted. I'm missing a quotation mark here, but that's okay. It still communicates. This is from the end of the letter. You are seeking proof of Christ who speaks in me. Now, the Corinthians did get some things right. They understood that Christ was speaking in his apostles. They just were deeply confused as to what the actual marks of an apostle were, the legitimation of an apostle. You are seeking proof of Christ who speaks in me, says Paul, who is not weak but powerful among you. For he also was crucified out of weakness, but lives by the power of God. It's instructive here and also at the beginning of chapter 3 that Paul describes the self-understanding of the Corinthians. Beginning of chapter 3, he says, are we defending ourselves again? Or do we need, as some do, letters to you or from you? The Corinthians had placed themselves in the role of judges of the apostles. That's why we had the factions. And Paul is going to indicate to them that they're taking on a role that doesn't belong to them, that they've flipped things upside down. And I had this little reminder at the beginning that this is in the first instance about an apostle. It's not about everyone who's called to Christian ministry, although there are implications out of this for that. But this has to do with the apostolic role. To put it visually, it's that the Corinthians want to place themselves above the apostolic word. And that's a role that no Christian is to be placed in. So for Paul, the apostolic word, the word of the cross, must perform its work in them. It has to work on them in order for them to see rightly and to judge the world rightly. They don't judge the word, but they are called to judge the world. But to do that, they themselves first have to be interpreted, given and shown their true identity by the gospel before they can rightly interpret and discern the world. From 1 Corinthians 3:15 for a moment, the spiritual person, Paul says, judges all things, and they themselves are judged by no one. Now, the hermeneutic, this phenomenon of understanding and of the communication of reality, this hermeneutic that Paul presents is unheard of. We cannot, of ourselves, crawl out of our own skin and do some sort of somersault and arise above our own limited and often self-serving perspectives to interpret ourselves and the world. We cannot, by our own methods, reflection, thought, and learning, arrive at a final interpretation of all things. Even if the false optimism of our time keeps this hope alive. I have a slight aside here, but it's relevant. I have a strong suspicion about all attempts by Christian interpreters to establish some sort of storyline of Scripture without any gaps by which everything is explained, because that seems to me also to place the interpreter in a role that we can't yet assume. We don't see, we believe that there is a storyline, that in God everything does serve a purpose, and this there is a story that has a happy ending. But we can't see across the gaps right now. To put it one other way, either we create a storyline into which we fit Jesus, or the entire story of God's dealings with us, including the reality of sin and death, and the heights of God's love are found in Jesus. Either Jesus is in the storyline, or the storyline is in him. And it seems to me the Scriptures point us to the latter. The storyline is in him. We can't gain the final perspective that will allow us to see all things as they are. I don't know if there's any Canadians here. Yep. I've looked at clouds from both sides now, from up and down and still somehow. It's clouds illusions, I recall. I really don't know clouds at all. That dates me a little bit too, but but I see it communicates here, which is good. Joni Mitchell. We can't see things as they actually are. We can't get there from him. But the Corinthians, and sometimes we as well, under the narcotic influence of dreams of power that we thought about last time, and the idolization of human gifts, suppose that they can get there. And throughout the Corinthian correspondence, Paul is seeking to bring the Corinthians back down to the earth, back down to reality. We Christians then operate with what I think can be called a material hermeneutic. I know that's a little bit technical. Again, hermeneutics have to do with understanding and interpretation. And very often, hermeneutics are understood as a set of rules by which we interpret texts. You learn the rules, you apply them to the texts and outcomes, understanding, like some gumball out of a machine. And this is unfathomable for the world. It's worth our reflecting on a little bit too. The gospel, I would argue, especially as Paul is presenting it here, compels us to a material hermeneutic. We begin understanding with the cross and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ. It's out of that that we are interpreted, and out of that that we then interpret the world. We can't take the first step. The first step has been taken for us. Our eyes are opened by the gospel and by the Spirit of God working through the Word that open our eyes to the world. A material hermeneutic. The beginning we heard from last time from Proverbs 1:7, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom. Not starting from a neutral position with some rules, enlightenment thought, and trying to interpret the world, but being given the interpretation from the very beginning. I know I'm preaching to the choir, but sometimes it's worth reminding ourselves of this and of the radical nature of it. I'm going off script just slightly, but one of the implications of this, about which Lutherans in particular have reflected and deserves further reflection, is the role of tradition, because we all stand in a tradition. I'm going to go further off script than I thought. So let me give you a very concrete example. We have some friends in the southwest corner of Germany where there's a university. And the man who was, thankfully he's not doing this any longer, he's moved on to other things, but the man who was in charge of religious education in the public schools, and they do have religious education in the public schools there, was provocative, sort of left-leaning provocative. And he maintained that Jesus never predicted his own resurrection, which is, of course, nonsense. But he disturbed people with that, quite understandably. I mean, this is the guy who's responsible for children being educated in the schools, and this is what he thinks. And we had some friends who were disturbed about it, and they wrote to, I'll leave it at this, a leader in the church there in town. And the leader wrote back, "In the university, we learned that we can't trust take the gospels at face value and all the things that flow from that." And I was struck by the naivety of that sort of response. In the university, we learned. Now, had it been a confession that, okay, I stand in the university tradition, I acknowledge that we don't have a corner on the truth, but you know, this is the tradition where I stand, and for whatever reasons, I could, okay, this is honest. But this is not how the letter was written. This was as written as if it was like a message from God on high. In the university, we learned. My point is, everyone stands in a tradition. Everyone. We want to stand in this tradition. Now, we have to think about that and what that means, and we have to, I want you to take this in the right sense. I mean it in the right sense. We have to engage the tradition critically. That's what Luther did, right? Otherwise, we wouldn't be here. That, I don't mean the sense of historical criticism, but I mean in the sense of out of the word itself. So all this is tied up in what Paul is doing here in 2 Corinthians 3. Now, I've mentioned already, he begins with this question, are we again defending ourselves? It's really no self-defense. Paul is not a genius or a charismatic rhetorician. That's what the Corinthians had wanted. He's an apostle who in his whole person, body and life, bears the message of another. He's not accountable to them. He's accountable to the crucified Christ. Up to this point, the Corinthians have imagined that they are the audience. They hear an apostle and watch the apostle preach. And precisely in this period, rhetoric was prized over against philosophy, the ability to communicate and to persuade. There were also suspicions about it. It wasn't entirely naive. But a fine and polished rhetorical presentation was the prize. Paul, in refusing to defend himself, tells them that the scene is entirely different from what they imagined. And I'm going to borrow from Søren Kierkegaard's devotional address. I'm not going to cite it, but Kierkegaard says, preaching in a church is not what we imagined it to be. It's not that the congregation is the audience examining and testing what the preacher has to say, although there's a measure of that. If we're Lutherans, we confess that. But it's actually a different situation. God is the audience. The congregation are the actors who have to learn their lines, and they have to learn them right. And the pastor is the prompter who's teaching the lines to the congregation. God is the audience of the whole thing. In a certain sense, in a picture, that's what Paul's doing to the Corinthians. They're saying, he says, no, God is the audience. God is the judge as to whether they've learned their lines properly, and he's also the judge of the apostle. So Paul presents his gospel on the basis of Scripture in 2 Corinthians 3, and like much of his use of Scripture and of the Scriptures generally, his use of the text is figural. I think it's useful for me to keep going off script a little bit. I'm thinking of Nathan the prophet's story of the man with the sheep to David. You know, the man who has the sheep. There's the pet. It's interesting, the Bible knows of beloved animals, pets in the family, and how this wicked rich man had all these sheep, and he takes the poor man's sheep away from him and slaughters it because he has a visitor, right? When he didn't need to. And, you know, David listens to the story, and then Nathan says to him, "Atahaish, you are the man." David is suddenly exposed in his own mind and heart for what he is through the story. The Scripture is replete with these stories in which who we are is exposed, revealed. We wouldn't have been able to hear it or understand it unless we'd heard the story and suddenly realize, oh, it's talking about me. And there are persons who have come to Christian faith, have been converted by precisely in this means, seeing themselves in the stories. That is what Paul is doing in 2 Corinthians 3. There's been confusion among interpreters because he speaks of Moses giving the law and of the sons of Israel, although note well, he says sons of Israel here, not Jews. It's been confusing for interpreters because some have thought, well, he must be addressing the problem of Judaizing, of Gentiles being asked to take on the law. No, it just doesn't appear anywhere in the Corinthian correspondence, or where it does appear one time briefly in 1 Corinthians 7, Paul's first word is to Jews, are you circumcised? Don't worry about it. There was surgery that could, Jews were attempted to go Greek. Paul says, don't worry about this. Just be circumcised then. And then he says, okay, and are you uncircumcised? Well, don't worry about that either. But note the context where he has to say to a Jew, it's okay to be Jewish. There can't be much pressure for Gentiles to Judaize. Jews are thinking of going Greek. That's Corinth. That's Corinth. So the passage, 2 Corinthians 3, is not about Judaizing. Paul is going to the stories of Scripture, and specifically in this instance, to the story of Moses giving the law, as a way of revealing to the Corinthians what is actually going on with them. That's the idea here. Now, there are three movements to Paul's argument in the chapter. In verses 1 through 3, let's see, I've got to catch myself up with my slides. In verses 1 through 3, he, as we've heard, asserts that the Corinthians themselves are evidence of his calling. Through him, by the Spirit, Christ has rewritten them and made them new. You know, he says to them, do we need letters to you or from you? We don't need no stinking letters. You are our letters. Interesting with a second word, written in our hearts. There's this bond of love between the apostle and the Corinthians, no matter what comes, the love of Christ. Known and read by everyone, being evidence that you are a letter of Christ. I take that to mean that you belong to Christ, but also that Christ is the one who has written you. Christ is rewriting the hearts of the Corinthians through the apostle. Letter of Christ administered by us, known and read by all. Christ is performing his work. And the gospel is not subject to annual review in Corinth. That's the issue at stake. Now, we should note for ourselves that we're not quite in the same circumstance, and we dare not place ourselves above those whom we have been sent to serve. Paul doesn't do that. He will, as he tells them in 2 Corinthians 1:24, not that we lord it over your faith. In their faith, the Corinthians and the apostle himself, and all of us, stand at the same level as the apostle, but he is the one who has been entrusted with this word. I'm going to focus for a moment on this other word from 3:2. Let me see if I have it in the next slide. Oh, not yet. Still in this one. The Corinthians are Paul's letter of commendation, as they have been written within his heart. Indeed, as I've noted, this letter is known and read by all human beings. Rather remarkable word. He speaks later in chapter 5 of having to stand before the judgment seat of Christ, and in the very next word he says, and therefore having been manifest to God, we hope that we're manifest to you. The reality of the final judgment is, in a sense, already taking place through the proclamation of the gospel. What is happening with the Corinthians is, so to speak, on display before the whole world, known and read by all human beings, by everyone. If it isn't at the moment, it will be. All the world knows that Paul is Christ's apostle to the Corinthians. That was a word of confidence on Paul's part, which in a remarkable way has established its veracity in that we have these letters. The whole world knows that Paul is apostle to the Corinthians, even if the Corinthians at that moment had doubt. The word did prevail with them, finally. Otherwise, the letters would have been thrown out, and we wouldn't have them. There's a word of apostolic confidence in the gospel there. And what we're interested in at this moment is Paul's remarkable confidence in the power of the gospel to change human hearts. We've heard already the Corinthians are a letter that Christ himself writes. They've been written, or we might say rewritten, not with ink, Paul says. That is, not on paper. Corinthians are asking for letters. He says, you're not written with ink, but by the Spirit of the living God, by the Spirit of the living God. References to the living God, quite often in the scriptures, are opposed to the dead idols. We've mentioned already that the Corinthians, in a certain sense, had fallen into idolatry. In a certain sense, these letters of recommendation were all right. Paul writes them for Phoebe, for example, at the conclusion of Romans, commending her, but not a letter of recommendation for an apostle, because his audience is God, not the church. This letter of Christ is written not on tablets of stone, and you can hear Moses giving of the law coming, not on tablets of stone. And now I'm going to assert that your versions probably have the next line a little bit off. Not on tablets of stone, but on tablets of fleshly hearts. The word that I've rendered fleshly, I'm quite confident this is right, is generally rendered human hearts in our versions. The thought is actually somewhat different, I would argue. It's not soft and warm human hearts. Paul is not directly thinking of Ezekiel 11 here, where God says, I will take the heart of stone out of your flesh and give you a heart of flesh, a feeling, living human heart. The thought is different. Notice in Ezekiel, God performs this divine operation, taking out the stone, heart of stone, and putting in a heart of flesh, heart transplant. But here, Paul says, we're writing on fleshly hearts. There's a passage in Jeremiah that may well come into play here where God describes the heart of Israel like stone that you have to inscribe with a diamond-tipped or hard-tipped pen. So what Christ is doing, as I've suggested, is rewriting the hearts of the Corinthians. He's writing over it. There's a technical term for manuscripts, papyri that have double, they're called palimpsests. There's one text that has been half, that's been erased, and then you write something over the top of it. That's what Christ is doing with the Corinthians. That, in other words, the point I want to make, God is writing right on top of, Christ is writing right on top of rebellious hearts, making them new. Now, Paul introduces this change in metaphors. He's shifting over to this giving of the law and the work of the Spirit in the gospel because he's been entrusted with the ministry of the new covenant, which as the work of God alone, makes him sufficient for the task entrusted to him. And in fact, he himself raises the issue of sufficiency just prior to this passage at the end of chapter 2. As the apostle of Christ, who is being led as a captive in a Roman triumph, he says he serves as an aroma of Christ within the world. For some, that is for those who believe, aroma of life bringing life, and for others, an aroma of death to death. Everything depends on whether you've been given the nose for it. It's interesting what Paul does with the senses here, whether you can smell life in this man who's being led to death, or whether you smell only the stench of death, only to those to whom it has been given, do they see life in it. In other words, the ministry of the gospel is nothing other than the imparting of eternal life, and where this word is rejected, there remains nothing but judgment and death. And then Paul asks, who is sufficient for these things? Now, that's not merely a response to the Corinthians, although it is that. It is a declaration of the radically extrinsic nature of Christian ministry and of apostolic ministry in particular. The sufficiency of the apostle does not lie in himself, but in God and in the gospel with which he's been entrusted. He says the same thing in 3:5. Now, as we've noted, at this point, Paul describes the nature of his ministry in this remarkable appeal to Scripture. God has made him adequate as an agent of a new covenant, think of Jeremiah 31, not of the letter, but of the Spirit. For as Paul explains, the letter kills and the Spirit gives life. I know that it could be rendered, but the little particle in Greek, de, can go either way. The history, as the late Gerhard Freddy notes, the history of interpretation has been the attempt to escape the death and emphasize life. So the general reading has been, the letter kills, but the Spirit gives life. But for Paul, it's not that way. The Spirit gives life only where the letter has put to death. This is our classic law and gospel. The surprising element of Paul's argument is that he finds a foreshadowing of the gift of the Spirit within the giving of the law, within Moses' administration of the law. Now, the continuity that he finds, that there is a glory in Moses' face, it is transcended by the glory of the gospel, the ministry of the new covenant. But there is a glory, and there is a certain continuity, that there is one work of God in contrasting movements, a coincidence of opposites within the divine purpose, or to put it more directly, in the crucified and risen Lord, what takes place also takes place in those who are his. Death is takes place in him. We've been put to death. In baptism into him, we've been put to death in order that we might be given life. No one can, we're back to our opening theme, no one can figure this out. It's not logical. Christians can understand it because they know that Jesus died and was raised for us, and we with him then. So in Moses' temporal glory, Paul sees a promise of eternal glory in Christ. If the ministry of death, I'm citing 3, 7, and 8, if the ministry of death came with such a brilliant divine glory, this is Paul, if the ministry of death came with such a brilliant divine glory that the sons of Israel could not bear to look upon the face of Moses that was radiant with this glory, then Paul asks the question, must not the ministry of the Spirit take place with even more glory? Now, the glory of Moses' face was seen. The ministry of the Spirit, or the glory of this ministry, is not yet fully or rightly seen. The function of the law, then, as executioner, becomes clear in Paul's following parallel elaboration in 3, 9, and 10. He's still appealing to the Exodus narrative of concerning Moses' face. If there was a glory to the ministry of condemnation, that's the law, the ministry of righteousness, Paul says, shall abound much more in glory. The question, rhetorical question, they just used is now replaced by a direct assertion. The ministry of righteousness shall abound much more in glory. The letter affects this death sentence on Israel, and not merely on Israel, but on the world, and it has its own glory. In the ministry of the new covenant, God forgives, renews, and recreates the fallen human being, and this ministry has much more glory. In fact, if I won't go into details of rendering the Greek, but Paul says that which had glory has no glory. It's the glory of the new covenant for Paul, if we can use this picture, is so bright that it's like the stars when the sun rises. You just don't see them anymore. The brightness of the sun dispels this former light because of its greater brightness. Now, in his third and final description of the new covenant, Paul takes up the contrast between the two covenants that he's just voiced. And he shifts away from Moses' ministry to looking at Moses' face and the way in which God revealed his glory even then. If there was a glory to that which is now done away with, that which remains and abides eternally itself bears glory. He's making this argument. I'll anticipate also where we're going here one more time. The sons of Israel could see the glory of Moses' face. The glory of the new covenant comes to us through our ears. Paul is arguing for it on the basis of the gospel. It has to be heard. You know, I can borrow from Luther here at the beginning of his commentary on Hebrews, the ears alone are the organs of a Christian. All the visual language that we're about to think about at the end of chapter 3 in 2 Corinthians, all that visual language is a metaphor for hearing. Sometimes interpreters get confused by this. If there was a glory to that which is now done away with, that which remains and abides eternally bears glory. There's the assertion on Paul's part. Paul takes up this Exodus narrative in 12 through 18, focusing on Moses' action. Moses placed a veil over his face in order that the sons of Israel might not look at the goal or end of that which is now done away. It's interesting how Paul puts it here. The glory that was in the law anticipates the glory of the new covenant. There's the continuity. It is all finally one work of God, death and life. The glory of the law from Sinai, the letter that brought death, is an anticipation of the greater glory that's given to us in Jesus Christ. And Paul enacts in speech here what Moses enacted with his veil. Moses' veil worked the hardening of the minds of the sons of Israel. There's an interesting contrast between what he says earlier in the chapter and what he says in 13 and 14. In the earlier story, he says the glory, there was such a brightness of the glory of Moses' face that the sons of Israel could not look at, stare at, unable to endure the glory of Moses' face. But now he speaks of an act of judgment. Moses places a veil over his face. This is like an action of one of the prophets who, in a parable, so to speak, does what God is doing through his prophetic message, through his word to the people. Moses, placing the veil on his face, does something to the sons of Israel. As Paul says in verse 14, it has not been revealed to them, that is to Israel, to the sons of Israel, that in Christ the old covenant has been done away with. And in verse 15, until today, whenever Moses is read, and he's thinking of the synagogue with which the Corinthians would have been familiar, because here in Corinth, as well as in other places, the church was born out of the proclamation of the gospel in the synagogue and then was forced out. Whenever Moses is read in the synagogue, a veil still lies on their hearts. In fact, in the following argument in chapter 4, Paul expands the picture here, quite clearly including the Corinthians and all the world. He says there that the God of this age has blinded the minds of unbelievers so that they cannot see the light of the gospel of the glory of Christ, who is the image of God. That's 4:4. Again, the story of Moses veiling his face, this biblical story, makes visible what is actually taking place in the world that the Corinthians and the rest of us would not see. The world which stands under divine judgment remains blind, to the glory of God's saving work in the crucified Christ, now risen. There's a turn in Paul's argument in verse 16. I use turn consciously. Moses himself takes a turn. And this is another place where I'm going to argue a bit with our versions. This is almost always taken because of the word turn. That when someone turns to the Lord, the veil is removed. That's how it's generally rendered. I don't think that's quite right. Throughout this passage, Paul still has in view the picture of Moses. We can hear it in the following verse in 17 and 18 as well. So it's still about Moses. Secondly, this has to do with a more technical question. The verb, which is rendered, it was removed as a passive, is much more likely active. He removed the veil. So rather than saying something about what generally takes place when someone's converted, when someone turns to the Lord, the veil is removed, Paul is saying something about what's taking place in Moses. As often as Moses turned to the Lord, that is, when he went to the tent of meeting, Moses took off the veil. That's actually what the Exodus story says. Now, it's a figure of what takes place when someone hears the gospel and believes. But it's still being expressed in terms of what Moses did. Just as Moses put on the veil so that the sons of Israel couldn't see, when he turns to the Lord, he takes it off. Here too, Moses' action anticipates the apostolic proclamation of the gospel, because Paul has started by saying, we're not like Moses, who used to veil his face. When he turned to the Lord, he took it off. He removed the veil. And then comes the payoff. Just as Moses removed his veil whenever he turned to the Lord, so we too, anticipating verse 18, view the glory of the Lord in the mirror. Paul strikingly includes all of us in this vision of the Lord's glory. And there's this remarkable interpretive statement that we have in 17 that we can't understand unless we still understand it as related to Moses. The Lord is the Spirit. What are you saying, Paul? There's even debate as to how one should render this, although I think this is the right way to go. The Lord is the Spirit, and where should emphasize this, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. This puzzling statement is best understood, I'm going to argue, as an interpretive one. He still has the text of Exodus in his mind. The Lord, whom Moses encountered when he went into the tent of meeting and removed the veil, is none other than the Spirit of God given through the gospel. That is, in this certain sense, Paul is identifying the Spirit with the Lord. Just as Moses met the Lord in the tent of meeting, so the Spirit is to be found in one specific location, namely in Christ and in the gospel that proclaims him. And where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. It's emphatic on Paul's part. He's actually making use of the image of the tent to explain the gospel. Now, in another sense, of course, God's Spirit is present everywhere, but he's not savingly present, working in the human mind and heart everywhere, but only in one place, in the gospel. And the freedom, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is freedom. Paul doesn't even bother to interpret it. Just there is freedom. He does not provide interpretation. He simply lets it be interpreted by the context of Exodus 34 and the story of Moses. freedom, in fact, his word about freedom is an expression of freedom. It's quite clear then, if we just think of the context of what Paul has said, and we have in mind Exodus 34 and the story of Moses' giving of the law, that freedom is freedom from the death and condemnation brought by the letter. It is likewise a freedom from blindness and hardness of heart. The veil is removed. In Christ, we meet God in the freedom of love and communication. At the very least, since the Enlightenment, our society has tended to think of freedom in terms of individual autonomy. This is a different kind of freedom. This is a freedom of communication in which, so to speak, the gates of paradise are opened again, in which we now can live in God's presence, in which we do live in God's presence and know his love for us in Christ and speak to him and he to us. This relation, freedom is the freedom of communication between the fallen creature and the Creator, established now through the cross and resurrection of Jesus. It's not the case that God talks to himself or comes to himself. It's rather that in Christ and in the gospel, God comes to his fallen human creatures and speaks to them, communicates his innermost depths to them, to their innermost depths. Verse 18. We all, with unveiled face, beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord, are transformed into the same image from glory to glory, just as from the Lord the Spirit. Now, as I've already suggested, this relationship of communication, although it's expressed in visual terms, takes place through the ears. This is coming about through the proclamation of the gospel. We see better with our ears than we do with our eyes, is what Paul is saying. But we do see. That's why Paul needs no letters of commendation. The Corinthians are his letter. The glory of the apostolic ministry is nothing other than the breaking in of the age to come, and it's not apparent to the naked eye. The Corinthians are having trouble right at this moment discerning it in Paul, just as the sons of Israel couldn't recognize it as they heard Moses read in the synagogue. Unbelievers' minds have been blinded by the God of this world. Seeing is a figure for perceiving with the heart. Life and righteousness in the crucified Christ and the love of God for us. Interesting what Paul says here. We all with unveiled face notice that it's, in contrast to Moses, now it's not merely the apostle who sees, but every last Christian, every last one of us. And then still with Paul, beholding in a mirror the glory of the Lord. I've mentioned before that there's no direct reference to Christ in 2 Corinthians 3. Here is just a little hint, I would suggest. As in 1 Corinthians 13, where he speaks of our now seeing in a glass darkly, in a mirror darkly, here he has this eschatological reserve, namely that we see presently through our ears, we don't yet see with our eyes. We behold as in a mirror the glory of the Lord. Through the mirror, we see Christ, who is the image of God. In him we find the glory of God, and we ourselves, as Paul says, are transformed from glory to glory. That's been taken in more than one sense. It can be taken in the sense of progress. seek glory, and then gradually I'm transformed. I'm not persuaded that that is what the text is saying. It need not be understood this way. What if it's simply this, that the glory of the Lord is communicated to those who are his by the gospel? Again, not in a visible way. But just as Moses entered the tent and came out with a glowing face, so we all are transformed into the same image, here and now. Here and now, we share in this hidden glory of Christ. Every last believer, everyone who belongs to Jesus, everyone's face is unveiled. Everyone sees the glory of the Lord. Every last Christian is transformed. I'm not denying progress in the Christian life. There is that. But this text, it seems to me, is simply speaking about the communication that now has been opened between the fallen human being and God through Jesus Christ. Just as it takes place, Paul goes back to what he said in 16, in 17, just as from the Lord, who is the Spirit. Now we all are like Moses in the tent. This promise is given to us in Christ. A couple last thoughts then. How am I doing? Not too badly. I mentioned at the outset that this first speaks to us as Christians, but it also has implications for those called to Christian ministry. And it's in that vein I want to offer these last comments. If the results of our preaching appear paltry to us, we have to remind ourselves that it wasn't much better for the Apostle Paul. The church in Corinth was no megachurch, and it's doubtful whether it consisted of more than 150 or so. And on top of that, it was divided into factions, and Paul was basically about to lose his position as the pastor of this church. The apostle who had planted it is about to be booted out. They couldn't boot him out, I guess, because he'd planted the church, but they could ignore him and put someone else in his place. And Paul, for his part, is practically at his wit's end with this church. He had been nearly consumed by it emotionally. There's evidence of that in 2 Corinthians. And he frames the entire body of the letter about in terms of his concern for them. If he had measured the value of his life and his life's work by what stood before his eyes, he would, citing him now, been most pitiful of all people. So the words still speak to us. And they warn us against substituting some sort of pious paganism for the gospel, some sort of substitute in which visible success supplants the real work of the gospel in human hearts, which always remains unseen. This is a curb to our pride and hope to our despair. We're pointed to the unseen realities of faith, hope, and love given to us in Jesus Christ and worked by the gospel alone. Thanks very much for your attention.